welcome everyone to our second midweek Lenten service, Ash Wednesday last week. We're going to continue our look at the Ten Commandments and reflecting upon the life of Christ and our sins. So we're going to be doing all sorts of, yes, that's where we're focused. Focus, I need to think focus. Okay. Yeah, anyway. Okay, so our service will follow the outline below. Our final hymn is a nighttime hymn. It's a lullaby, so hopefully you will appreciate that. So we sing our opening hymn number 435. We rise and we follow the order of service as printed in the bulletin. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Hearing the word of God to receive its comfort and power, let us first come before the Lord and examine our lives in light of God's commandments as we have learned them.
For the word of God is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing to the division of soul and of spirit, of joints and of sorrow, and discerning the thoughts and intentions of the heart.
Let us pray together. Heavenly Father, from your first commandment telling us that we are to give you first place in our lives, to the tenth commandment telling us to be content with what we have sinned against all of them in thought, word, and deed. Instead of speaking the truth in love, we have spoken falsely against our neighbors.
tearing others down instead of building them up. We know from your holy word that you are a God of mercy and forgiveness. We ask for your forgiveness in the name of our Savior Jesus Christ, who paid the penalty for our sins by his precious blood.
God has told us in his word, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Upon this, your confession, I, as a called and ordained servant of Christ, and by his authority, forgive you all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Thanks be to God.
O Lord, open my lips,
and my mouth will declare your praise.
Make haste, O God, to deliver me.
Make haste to help me, O Lord. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Praise to you, O Christ, Lamb of our salvation.
Therefore, having put away falsehood, let each one of you speak the truth with his neighbor, for we are members one of another.
Whoever goes about slandering reveals secrets, but he who is trustworthy in his spirit keeps a thing covered.
Do not speak evil against one another, brothers.
Open your mouth for the mute, for the rights of all who are destitute. Open your mouth, judge righteously, defend the rights of the poor and needy.
Love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things.
Above all, keep loving one another earnestly, since love covers a multitude of sins.
Please be seated for our hymn. These are the Holy Ten Commands, verses 1, 9, 11, and 12. This is an old Reformation era hymn designed to teach the Ten Commandments.
Thank you. second reading is from Psalms 15, verses 1 through 5. O Lord, who shall sojourn in your tent? Who shall dwell on your holy hill? He who walks blamelessly and does what is right, and speaks truth in his heart, who does not slander with his tongue, and does no evil to his neighbor, nor takes up a reproach against his friend, and in whose eyes a vile person is despised, but who honors those who fear the Lord, who swears to his own heart and does not change, who does not put out his money at interest, and does not take a bribe against the innocent. He who does these things shall never be moved. O Lord, have mercy on us.
Thanks be to God.
Return to the Lord your God, for he is gracious and merciful, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love, Congregation is invited to rise.
The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 26th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Then those who had seized Jesus led him to Caiaphas, the high priest, where the scribes and the elders had gathered, and Peter was following him at a distance. As far as the country yard of the high priest, and going inside, he sat with the guards to see the end. Now the chief priests and the whole council were seeking false testimony against Jesus that they put him to death, but they found none. Though many false witnesses came forward, at least two came forward, and said, This man said, I am able to destroy the temple of God and to rebuild it in 3 days. And the high priest stood up and said, Have you no answer to make? What is this that these men testify against you? But Jesus remained silent, and the high priest said to him, I adjure you, by the living God, tell us if you are the Christ, the Son of God. Jesus said to him, You have said so, but I tell you, from now on you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of power and coming to the clouds of heaven. Now the high priest tore his robes off and said, He has uttered blasphemy. When further witness we need, we have now heard his blasphemy. What is your judgment? They answered, He deserves death. Then they spit in his face and struck him, and some slapped him, saying, Prophesy to us, you Christ. Who is that struck you? This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Deliver me, O Lord my God, for you are the God of my salvation.
Rescue me from my enemies. Protect me from those who rise against me.
In you, O Lord, do I put my trust. Leave me not, O Lord my God.
Rescue me from my enemies. Protect me from those who rise against me.
Deliver me, O Lord my God, for you are the God of my salvation.
Rescue me from my enemies. Protect me from those who rise against me.
What is the eighth commandment?
You shall not give false testimony against your neighbor.
What does this mean?
We should fear and love God so that we do not tell lies about our neighbor, betray him, slander him, or hurt his reputation, but defend him, speak well of him, and explain everything in the kindest way.
The congregation may be seated. The explanation of the eighth commandment, I always remember the older way, put the best construction on everything. And that's the same thing as explaining things in the kindliest way. Day was breaking. Those who had been assembled hastily at the high priest's house were probably still yawning and trying to shake off the lamb and the wine from last night's Passover meal. Jesus had been arrested in the Garden of Gethsemane and was led bound to the high priest's house. During the arrest, there was a scuffle. The sword of Malchus, the right ear of Malchus was swiped off and Jesus healed it. But they knew that they were dealing with a dangerous man. And so Jesus came led, bound to the high priest's house. In the way that things worked at this time, the Jewish theocracy, the religious leaders, the Sanhedrin and the chief priests would execute the justice from the Jewish court. The Roman court would give their seal of approval to what the Jewish court would decide. This trial at this time of the day was highly unusual. But they had made a decision that Jesus had to die. They had laid out the trap. They had one of his followers, disciples, Judas became the mole, the rat. They paid him the 30 pieces of silver. Judas did indeed go out and betrayed the Son of Man with a kiss. And they had their culprit. So they were there. They assembled the court, the Sanhedrin, and they knew what the evidence needed to be. They knew what the end result needed to be, and that is that Jesus needed to die. But the trial itself was such that was uncertain, because what the Jews decided, the Romans didn't always go along with. And so they needed something that was so earth-shattering, so damning, so legally watertight, that an appeals court would toss out any kind of appeal before it could get any further. There was no way in their mind that Jesus could be let off the hook. So what do they do? What do they seek? Do they seek to tell the truth? Quite the contrary. Verse 59 of our text said, "Now the chief priests and the whole council were seeking false testimony against Jesus, that they might put him to death." They're looking for tainted jurors, tainted witnesses. I'm not sure if anyone's ever had to serve as a witness in the court. It is a nerve-wracking experience. Maybe you've gone before the court because you've had a traffic ticket or whatever, and even that relatively mild thing, the anxiety goes up and you get nervous because of the implication of it. And yet, in Jesus' case, the criminal justice system was criminally unjust. False witnesses they were looking for. They were called to not tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. They were instead to try to fabricate something so that Jesus would die. False testimony was the name of the game. It didn't work. The different testimonies contradicted one another. They sacrificed their own good name. Proverbs 22:1 states, "A good name is more desirable than great riches. To be esteemed is better than silver or gold." A witness was to be a person of integrity, a person of his or her word, fearless and godly. And yet, without blinking of an eye, the people that came forward would not hesitate to lie. They would not hesitate to put an innocent man to death. These liars at the trial led to the conviction of the only perfect, sinless person that has ever lived and that will ever live until Jesus calls us all home in his glory. Now, we shouldn't be too quick to judge. And we shouldn't give, all those, religious leaders. Because in the courtroom of life, if we think about it, we too have a tendency of bearing false witness against our Savior. We become like Peter from time to time, who claimed three times, "I don't know him." And then the cock crowed. By our casualness in prayer and Bible reading, by our seemingly unimportance of our devotional lives, we give the testimony, Jesus doesn't really matter. Yeah, I go to church, once or twice a week, but the whole Jesus thing, it's nice to have, and I'll take it when I need it. Right now, I don't need it. And instead of fearing, loving, and trusting God above all things, we certainly don't show it that way. When we pursue courses of action that are right in our own eyes, but are contrary to Scripture, we are really bearing false witness. Sometimes our false witness is an attempt to be no witness at all. We hear of someone attacking a Christian. We hear of someone who is being belittled. We hear of somebody that should be stood up for. And yet we choose to be silent, hoping that people won't notice us. Instead of putting the best construction, everything that Jesus does has done for us, we become quiet. Instead of speaking well of Jesus to our neighbors, instead of defending Jesus and the faith he gives us, we become quiet. We deny him. We deprive others the opportunity of hearing the life-giving gospel. The false testimony before the Sanhedrin didn't work. The testimony was contradictory. What condemned Jesus is when they accidentally sort of stumbled on a partial truth. Something of that Jesus said, and they sort of twisted it around. Jesus had preached, "Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will rebuild it." He said that. Now the temple he was talking about was his body. And the rebuilding in the third day was his resurrection. So what the witnesses said was true. Jesus did say that. Not what he meant out of context, but it is true. Now, at this point, Jesus could have spoken up. At this point, Jesus could have explained things. Yep, I said that, this is what I mean. But instead, he remained silent. And then they asked the leading question. Have you no answer to make? What is it that these men testify against you? And the high priest said, I adjure you by the living God, tell us if you are the Christ, the Son of God. And Jesus said, you have said so. But I tell you, from now on you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of power, coming on the clouds of heaven. Blasphemy, blasphemy! And they ripped their robes, and they knew that Jesus had condemned himself. They knew that Jesus had allowed himself to be given up, that he tacitly agreed with the outcome of the trial. The verdict was in. The court was concluded. Jesus had to die. And Jesus did have to die. He claimed he had to die, that the Son of Man must be betrayed into the hands of simple men and be crucified, and the third day rise again. He had to die for all those who bear false witness. He had to die for all those who break the eighth commandment. What the court meant for evil, Jesus turned and used for good. For your good, for your eternal good, for your salvation. All your breaking of the eighth commandment, all the slandering, gossiping, false witnessing, lying, and because we do not fear, love, and trust in God above all things, Jesus willingly takes from you. He insists on it. All your sin is now his. It all belongs to him because he carries it and answers for it in his temple. That is his body on the cross. Jesus does what must be done with your sin. In order to save you, the sinner, in his temple, that is, in his body, he wraps himself with all of your sin and gets damned with it. Then he pulls off an Easter Sunday on the third day in order to tell you the truth. The truth is this: you, yes, you, sinner, you are forgiven. Your sins don't count against you. You have been freed. There is no more condemnation for you in Christ Jesus. It's that Easter resurrection that speaks no evil of you. He refuses to betray you. He refuses to slander you. Jesus refuses to give false testimony about you to the Heavenly Father. He, in truth, declares you to be forgiven in righteousness. Now the Lord does have good things for us to do. Eighth commandment things for us to do. And we all want to be used for good. We don't want to be bums, at least most of us, I don't think we do. We want to build up our neighbor. We want to edify our neighbor. We want to speak well of everybody. We want to speak well of our neighbor. We want to speak well to our neighbor. We want to explain everything in a kind way, put the best construction on everything. We know what it is to have the messiness of our lives comfortably hidden. And we respect that hiddenness in others until they're ready to bring it to the gospel light. Our tongues are used for positivity, not for negativity. Our tongues are used for building up and not tearing down. Our speech is marked with love, a love that covers a multitude of sin. We do not presume that we are in the position to judge, to condemn, or to broadcast publicly everybody else's dirty laundry. Instead, we relate with our neighbors as one for whom Christ died. We relate with our neighbors with dignity and respect. We relate with our neighbors so that the love of Christ in us is unmistakable. We are God's people. That's good news. We are forgiven. That's very good news. Let us be the people that He has declared us to be. In Jesus' name, amen. At this point, we rise as we speak together the canticle Magnificat. Let my prayer rise before His incense.
And the lifting up of my hands as the evening sacrifice. My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior.
For He has regarded the lowliness of His handmaid. For behold, from this day all generations will call me blessed. For the Mighty One has done great things to me, and holy is His name. And His mercy is on those who fear Him from generation to generation. He has shown strength with His arm. He has scattered the proud in the imagination of their hearts. He cast down the mighty from their thrones and has exalted the lowly. He has filled the hungry with good things, and the rich He has sent empty away. He has helped His servant Israel in remembrance of His mercy, as He spoke to our fathers, to Abraham and his seed forever.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
Please be seated. We praise God with our tithes and offerings.
Thank you.
We rise as we continue with the Kyrie. It's printed in the bulletin. Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. God of truth, you handed over your Son, Jesus Christ, at the false testimony of sinners, that he might die in our place as the atoning sacrifice for our sin. Grant that your word of truth may constantly be on our lips, so that we may show forth the love of our Savior in word and in action. Through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
O God, from whom come all holy desires, all good counsels, and all just works, give to us, your servants, that peace which the world cannot give, that our hearts may be set to obey your commandments. Cleanse us from all gossip and falsehood, that we may speak truthfully of both you and our neighbors. As you defend us from the fear of our enemies, enable us to live in peace and quietness. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Let us bless the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
Amen.
Please be seated as we sing hymn number 887.